six when it started. And for the first 3 years, I was used as what was called an expendable child. In the Belgian network, there was a group, particularly aristocrats, who killed children. So I was, a few times I was in situations like that, but I just happened to not be killed. So in this network, you have to understand it's a murderous network. Expendable children, that means that they can be killed. That's to say, it was clear that their lives wasn't valued, so those children could be used for anything. That could mean they could be reused for, they could be used for torture and killing. So it's very hard to talk about what happened to me during those first 3 years, because it was very extreme. So I was in quite a few extreme situations. I was sometimes taken to bars and given to all to the men there, but other times I was taken to castles, so, and then waiting with a handler until the people, you know, until the first group of people had left, and then at the late hour the younger children were brought in. Sometimes I was taken to somebody's house for the day. My mother would keep me out of school and then just drive me to somebody's house, and then whatever was necessary. I have remembered things about being in extreme situations with, you know, where other children did die. So my mother was being paid for this. What would happen then with an expendable child is the parents get paid. Of course, there's no contract. Nothing is in writing. It's all very vague. My mother's denial itself took care of a lot, but there was money exchanged, and her contact person was this countess. But let's say if I would have been killed and, you know, other children were, then a doctor who was part of the network would have been able to write a certificate, a death certificate, and bring up. So in 1972, I was traded by the boss of the network to an international player, somebody who was in the international network that the boss of the network wanted to do business with, wanted to be in this, their good favor, because this was someone who had global power. And this person found, apparently had this countess ask my mother who my father was, and also they drew blood. Anyway, they found out that I'm from one of the bloodlines, which is something that in this global network is very important. So this perpetrator then decided that he was going to get me trained, that's to say mind control trained, which is torture based, and to make me an elite slave, and to even give me a platform on the world stage so I could be an elite slave to the most powerful men in the world. So elite slaves are trained, most of them are trained from a very young age, and they can be people who are actually famous, but are actually being used as slaves, because it's all about the same kind of mafiosi style. I was being trained to spy, and also I was literally trained to make men fall in love with me at age 9. It was about a month long initially, but it was really a year long. The whole training was a year long, and meanwhile I was already being used. I was taken to Germany on weekends and spent it with someone who I realized later was a very big politician in Germany at the time. I mean, I was, not only did he really like me, but I was also spying on him, and I was reporting about his weakness then to who had become my owner, which was this international network. Basically, when I was going to Germany on the weekends with this, being driven there by handlers of the Belgian network and then dropped off in places picked up by on the side of the road, actually a quiet road, by this politician, and then I would just simply drive with him. And so because I had been trained, I knew how to not be, you know, not call attention to myself. He would check in, and this was very similar each time. It was always very idyllic, beautiful places on the beautiful rivers in Germany, in some small hotel pension, and there's maybe 3 or 4 rooms, and so he would have the whole hotel to himself, but we would sleep in the same bed. And then of course it would be all, it was all about pleasing him and for him I know that there was a great joy, or maybe pleasure is the right word, in having these people, you know, just fawn all over him and be so grateful and lucky that this very important person is visiting them and is gracing them with his presence. And they would say that, you know, if anything, he would say that I'm his niece. But I, of course, my German, I mean, he actually taught me to speak German, this politician. I mean, better. You know, I didn't really speak it very well. So when we were alone, you know, it had a lot to do about. But he was also just very happy. He seemed just very happy to be around a little girl that was there for him in this way that I was, you know, just listening. I thought, you know, I thought he was great and he was a really good man. And that was my training, of course, as a slave, is to flatter him to the max so that he would feel really good about himself. And that's how he got to feel good about himself. And so he clearly enjoyed the physical closeness a lot, and the warmth, and what then appeared to be love for him, I think. So this 1 year was very peculiar, that I was actually being groomed then on a big scale. And my owner, if I can say that, obviously this person who wanted to own me as a slave, had plans for me, and this was discussed even with other people in the network. So it was decided I was going to be a star in France. Everyone was treating me like a star. Yeah, that's really all I can say. And I had somebody who was giving me facial massages, other massages, but nothing creepy about these massages. There was a photographer, nothing creepy about the photographs, even though I was naked. Everybody was just making me into what I was to become, which was a French singer. There was a singing coach there, actually, and I was, you know, again, there was nothing I could do wrong. Everything was positive. So there was no correction. It wasn't really correction. Everything was, it's like kind of how we are taught now to treat our kids, you know, to just focus on the positive. But I never experienced that before. And suddenly there's this voice coach, and you know, he brings out the best out of my voice, the purity of the voice, and teaching me to sing certain songs, again, through repetition, certain French songs, Edith Piaf, Jacques Brel. And I was singing these songs, and it was easy. The French came back very easily. Eventually, I was going to be inducted into the cult. And so being inducted into the cult eventually was sort of my graduation, I guess, or it was to be the beginning of my new life, let's say. And there's been a lot of talk during that year about what my life was going to be, how comfortable, the most beautiful apartments in Paris, the, you know, the best house on the Côte d'Azur, the yacht, the respect, the platform. You know, everybody would think I was the best singer, actress in the world, and I would get all the magazine out. You know, it was all prepared. And it was just that what I had to do to belong eventually was just too much. I rebelled and was kicked out. Basically, I was reprogrammed, and I was extremely humiliated and punished. And this was reprogramming to make sure I would never become successful. After I was put back in the Belgian network, Belgians never really discovering what had actually happened to me, used me for their VIPs then. But a young gangster came into the network, and he had power in the Belgian network because he wasn't afraid to use a gun. But eventually, a year later, he ended up rescuing me. So now it's back to my mother driving me to the network. And once this gangster showed up, things changed a little bit, because he would keep me longer and so forth than usual. And so also groomed me for 6 months, in fact, and started by protecting me and then ended up abusing me worse than anybody else. Such violence. And then, you know, that would have resulted in my being murdered. And then he had a change of heart. And then he made a deal with the boss of the network to get me out. The physical circumstances of this gangster's name is Patrick Amers, and the politician who was in charge of the network is Paul van den Boeynants, who had a long career in politics in Belgium, and the gangster had also quite a fascinating career in crime. And the deal in 1974 that was made when this gangster was 22 years old, I think, or 23, was that he was going to work for the politician to get me out. He was going to become his whatever left-hand man. And what he did at age 11 is he gave me instructions for life, and they were extremely detailed. He told me never to become a to never sleep with anyone for anything, never do it. That I should not become a drug addict, that I should never buy drugs. They told me I should not become an alcoholic. I could have a little wine here and there, but I should never drink too much. No hard liquor, once a week for hard liquor, or some crazy rule like that. He told me that I should leave the country, that I should leave Belgium, that I have to go to Paris, London, New York. I have to settle in New York, and I should marry someone who is not an older man who made his own fortune, but someone my age who is from a wealthy family, preferably a family of New York bankers. This all came out of his mouth as he was basically driving me home the last time. And of course, it included to never speak about the network, never say anything to anyone, just never do it. And these life instructions, they settled very deeply inside myself, because he had done this one good act in his life. You know, he had done this thing that was selfless for me. And it was in very dramatic circumstances. And these directions became sort of my guidelines for life. That really got me through, that really helped me. He also gave me some to deal with my mother in the coming weeks, in, you know, the weeks that would follow, because he knew she would be angry that she couldn't take me to the network anymore. And he told me to try to leave that house as soon as I could. So once I was rescued from the network, I really was never trafficked again. I followed those guidelines that had been given to me very, very closely. So at age 16, I actually ended up in the red light district in Antwerp. And because of this direction, I never slept with anyone. I was able to reach high functioning levels again, and not just function well in society, but have more empathy and love for people, and really heal as a human being and as a soul. And I think it's important to look and uncover this darkness, however hard that is for each person, before we can actually create that change. And I think ultimately we are the ones that need to change.